Hey there, everybody. Thank you for joining today. I have 2 o'clock on my watch, so we're going to get started. And we are starting at 2. So, Christy, thank you. Hopefully, you can hear me. So, today, what we're going to be doing is we're going to be talking about the UV84 and its textured feature. Most of you may know textured is dimensional printing using the ink. And one of the newest applications we've come up with that was brought to us by a customer is actually creating donor memorial plaques. So we create texture and use varnish to enhance the fonts and graphics of the image to create memorial and donor plaques. And the reason this is important is that most donor plaques, memorial plaques are typically cast, and so it takes weeks for these cast signs to get made before they hang them up in, say, a hospital, a school, a college. You know, whenever you walk into a hospital, they always have a wall of donor plaques. You know, so-and-so donated so much money or so many years of service. So this is a great way to replicate that and also be able to provide a more unique signage and open up maybe towards the new niche for some of you. And for those of you who don't have direct color systems, this is just one of many things that you can do with your printers. And what we're going to show you too is also how to use the badge feature for added functionality so that you can add in multiple names, you can add in different numbers, serial numbers, and all that stuff while still using the textured feature. So we have a quick presentation to give. And then what we're going to do is we're just going to jump right into software. And Steve Dworak will be showing us how to use the software for the badge feature. And it's going to be a step-by-step. So please, as we're moving forward, ask questions. There's a Q&A feature within Zoom. You can ask questions there. Or you can go to the chat feature and you can type up questions there. We'll see it and we'll answer them as we're going along. All right, so DCS is in Rocky Hill, Connecticut. That's our main headquarters. That's where everything's manufactured, sample requests, all that fun stuff. We also have another location in Portugal for our headquarters for Europe, Africa, Asia, which also does sales and some tech support. But let's move on into textured and features. The UV84 can also print flat graphics as well, so you're not stuck just printing textured, as well as ADA and Braille. So when we jump into the Colorbyte 10 software, you can do ADA, Braille, print flat graphics, but today we're going to be focusing on that textured software module. The array function is also a pretty important function as well as bad for what we're doing today. The array will lay out the signs on the table. And then the badge function can actually add in different variable data. So if you have a list of names, you can take a list of names from a Excel file and it will take those names and put them into the spot on the sign where you want different names. So you don't have to create 20 different names for 20 different signs. You create one name, one sign, and then pull this in and it will duplicate all of those signs with the different names. It's just a way, once you learn how to use it, it's a fast way to make a lot of signage, especially if it's all the same. We're using the UV84 right now, and that is 96 by 48 inches. We do have the UV53, which is a little smaller, but the UV84 uses Ricoh Gen 5 print heads. The ink cost is $2.50 per liter. Yearly maintenance, there barely is any other than ink filters. So when we are talking about, you know, true running costs or, you know, maintenance costs, it's very low, very low. There's no capping stations, no crazy software or anything like that. It's all relatively low maintenance. So what we're going to do now is Steve's going to show us how to use the software. I'm going to stop sharing and Steve's going to take it from here.
All right, guys, how you doing? So first we're going to go in the front end of the software to show you how to manipulate the artwork to make your textured memorial plaque. Let me just share my screen here. So I have some step-by-step instructions that I could send you guys after the demo. To start with, basically, as you see on the front of the screen here, I'm going to be printing on a 12x24 piece of gold aluminum ink, actually ink mark gold aluminum. We do have them in 24x48, but I'm just going to do one row for demo purposes. So you could see here that I have three elements. So we have our, just delete that. Oh, sorry. So we have our size here of the actual plaque is going to be 9x12, and then our inside rectangle or solid shape is what the color of the background is actually going to be of the plaque. So you could change that. You'll see in when we print them, I made them several different colors. What we're just going to do black right now. And then we have our elements here of the object. So we have text, we have an inline and a logo, and this is all in clear. And then we have our actual, JPEG or anything, any bitmap file you could Google and find as a textured background. So all I did basically was I typed in a rock texture. I found an image that had some, gradients and darks and lights to get that texture element. So
and,
once
and
you have
we've
that.
Done the same thing. We've done the same thing with other textures too. So like we've done leather, we've done patterns. So you're not stuck with just, rock, but the reason Steve chose this is that a cast sign usually has this kind of pebbly face on it that's usually enameled.
Correct. So yeah, you could bring in anything you like. Import, there's about 40 different filters in the front end of Colorbyte. So you could import any kind of image that you think could be a good textured background for your plaque. So from there, pretty simple. So we would actually size each one up. So we would size this accordingly to your actual size of plaque. So this is going to be, the size of this is about 8.25x11.25. And then you would actually create this here. So you put in your text, your logo, and your outline, and make sure it fits in or fits into that solid shape. And then you would import your texture. So from there, you would take your textured image here, and we would want to create that and make that a grayscale. So what we do is go to image, mode, grayscale. So once that's a grayscale, you're able to kind of use your curve data, which I'll show you, to manipulate the contrast between dark and light, black and white. So from there, we're going to go to image, color adjustment, curves. All right, so this here is your color adjustment or your curve adjustment here. So basically, you could play around, you could invert it prior or leave it as is. But what I want to do is kind of get as much contrast as possible. And if you could play around, if you don't like it, you could always reset to the beginning here. And then, so I usually, the best results I get usually is if I go up around your 90-80% here and drag that up, and then go to about your 30-40% and drag that down. So you're going to get your darks dark and your light areas kind of white. So once you hit okay, it changes that to more of contrast between those darks and lights. From there, all we need to do is pretty simple. We need to create a spot. We need to render this spot color. So to do that, you select the image, go to transform, render to multi-tone bitmap. So that's gonna actually see it as a spot color. So what we're gonna do is change it. You could either change it to your duotone, which is gonna use clear and white to build up the texture, or you could use, we have a Braille duotone. It's going to use clear and white as well, but it's going to use a little less ink, just depending on what you're going for, what you're looking for. So I'm,
so if you want the max, you would use the
duotone. Yeah. So Braille duotone uses less. In that in that case, you would use Braille duotone if you want to use if you want that clear ink where you see here where it says Memorial and the Eagle to be a little higher than the actual textured background. So you'd use the Braille duotone. But in this case, we're just going to use our standard duotone. Okay, and then pretty simple. So we're going to take our texture, and we're just going to center it directly on top of that rectangle. Okay, so once it's centered.
We do have a question, Steve.
Yep.
This will be available. We are recording this. We are going to post it to YouTube, and we will send everyone here the link so that you guys can practice this yourself if you already have Colorbyte. Or if you're looking at a printer like the UV84 and you want to, you know, show this to other people within your organization. So this will be available and you will get a link.
Yeah. And I, as you see here, also, I came up with a little step-by-step document that I could send to all of you after the demo as well. So just what we did was we centered the textured objects on top of the inside of the solid shape. And then from there, what we're going to do is simply just hit your overprint button. So it's the button on the bottom left-hand corner, it's overprint. So what that does is it actually kind of layers it behind the solid shape. Okay, so it brings it behind. So when you send it into the queue, it'll recognize it as an underprint. I know it says overprint, but it recognizes it as a kind of an inline layer to print before the color. So once you have that, you want to make sure that all these objects here are grouped. So you're gonna, quick way to group it is Control G, grouped. And then what we're gonna do is center it right on top of the texture layer. Oops, sorry. There you go. Alt G. Let me just get rid of this here. Control G. And now center it. So basically that's it. So we have our solid shape, our textured layer, and then our logo and font, which is in front. So you want to make sure that it's in that order. Because if I had the textured on top of the actual clear pass, which is the text and the logo, then it won't recognize it in the queue or in the rip, I should say. So from there, so we created our textured plaque. And what we want to do is for the variable data information, you just want to, I already have it here. So you can make it any color. You could actually, you know, assign it clear as well. But I basically, so I want to bring that to forward as well. Bring it up on top as a top layer. And I made it magenta so I could see it easier. But obviously once you send it to the rip, you want to make sure that it's a clear spot clear color. So you just want to center both. So what I'm doing to center it is selecting shift and then C. So that's going to center. And then basically you're going to make sure, well, before that, sorry. You want to make sure that everything besides the text is grouped together. So we're gonna select all, control group, and then now we're gonna put this back where it was here, and then control F for forward. Or if that doesn't work, you just wanna go into your, we use layers as well. So we're gonna go to view layer, and it has our layer here. So we're gonna hit icon, and then we're gonna have move to top. Okay. And then we're going to move this to top as well. There we go. That's not. Okay, let's just do this here, move that up here. Okay. So once we have, sorry, we have the text set and then your variable data, which is the name and the date, we're basically going to select it, go to layout, badges. So in your badge function, it's going to it's going to give you basically number of copies. So that's going to be actual the number of, let me go put it back in the blank size. Okay. Sorry, go layout badges. Okay. So this is going to give you the actual number of copies that you could input into the blank size. So if I do custom, let's just have my blank size at, it was 48. No, it was 12 by 48. And then we actually, and you could actually use, if you have a acquired blank size in your front end, it just deselect that and it's going to use the standard blank size that you made in the front end. So we could fit five plaques, and then basically we have your margins, pretty simple. It's all in the instructions that I'll send you as well. Your margins, you could put margins in, left, top, bottom, right. And then you have your spacing, vertical and horizontal spacing. So there's a little preview here on the bottom left side that shows you how many you could fit on that actual piece that you're printing on. To change the variable data, basically you want to make sure it says here highlight text to be changed. So you want to make sure you highlight this before you hit OK. So once you highlight it, you hit OK, it's going to give you names that you could input. So I mean, you could type them in. As you go. Or you could obviously, if your customer has a document with names, you could copy and paste them, any customer thing. So just like that, I can't think of names, of course. So you would just fill it all in and then put the dates in here as well. So let's do that really quick. Let's put one date in. And then Control C. And then, you know. Okay. And then you just put the names in. Again, you could copy, paste, hit OK. And then it's going to actually populate it on your screen. I don't know why this must be locked. But if I take this, bring it up. So it would populate it as so. I'm not sure why that. Is blocking it.
Well, I think, I mean, they get the point that you can add in the variable data and it will change it all.
There it goes. So yeah, so it changes it all. That layer must be locked somehow. But yeah, so it's going to change all your data here. See how it inputs it automatically. So from there, you're going to highlight it. And I mean, if you had it at clear in the first place, that's fine, but you're gonna change it to clear. And then what we're gonna do is actually highlight all the objects and we're gonna send them to the RIP. So send to RIP. And pretty simple, the 84 has basically three different queues. They're standard, ADA, and texture. So basically we're just gonna click on texture, hit OK. And then once it goes into stop share, the queue, all you need to do from there is right click, hit print. And then once you hit print, it's going to ask you to save it to a folder. So basically it's going to save as a PRN file. You put it on a folder on the network or wherever you'd like. And then from there, your operator would actually use the printer driver software to locate the file on the folder and send the print to the computer. I mean, import it into the computer and send it to the printer. So
yeah. And that is set up this way so that, you know, you can have your graphic designers doing graphic design, saving it to your server or some other location, right? Like Google Drive or something. And then your operator can just go grab the print file by the job number, right? So that way if you have one of our 1800s or 7200s, the software is connected to the printer and you have to sit by the printer when you're designing software. This way is more efficient. You know, you can design from anywhere that you have the software, save it to a server or a online, you know, cloud system. And then the operator can focus on being an operator and printing, laminating, cutting, getting stuff out the door instead of having to try to design and make changes on the fly.
So what I'm trying to do, sorry guys, is I can't share two screens. So I'm going to try to show you the screen here. So this is this is the device software or the printer driver software.
Coming up, Steve.
What's that? Can you see it?
No, it's not coming up.
Let me see. Oh, here we go. Okay. So this is what the operator would be using. So he would set up his actual material, right? And basically you have a few settings that are in the user guide that you would change for a texture. I don't know, you guys can't see it here, but if I go to my printer options, there's settings that you would use your white thickness at 2, your clear thickness at 2, and then these are just use your data from your RIP data. So you just leave it there. And then there's a layer mode that there's only 3 options, normal, ADA, and texture. You click on texture, you hit apply. And then basically you would just import that file into this, into the driver software, which would appear on this list here or right here. So basically I would open, I would locate that PRN that you created from the RIP. And then basically you just click on it, hit open, and it appears right here. So you guys could see, I changed the colors on these just to give you some, to show you, you know, it just doesn't print black. So basically from there, we're gonna turn the machine vacuum on.
And we do have a question. Question here is, can you produce artwork on a Mac using Illustrator and then send to the printer? You can create files in Illustrator, CorelDRAW. I mean, the only thing is, if you use CorelDRAW, is that you want to save it as a PDF or another file format, because CorelDRAW files are .cdl files, which are the same as Colorbyte, which is CDL. So when it goes to read those files, it gets confused. But if you save as a PDF, bitmap, JPEG, you know, PNG file, I mean, you can print a lot of different files with Colorbyte. If you're doing ADA Braille or textured, I would use the Colorbyte software. So if you wanted to design your sign in Illustrator and then bring it over and do the textured part in Colorbyte and send it to the RIP, I would recommend doing that. But yes, you can use Illustrator on a Mac. But the Mac can't run the Colorbyte software. It's a Windows-based software. So again, if you have any questions, feel free to use the chat feature, the question and answer feature. Right now, the printer's starting. Should take about 10 minutes. You can see it's putting down white first, right? So we talked about that. It's using white and clear to help build the height so that we can get that texture. And as it prints, you'll see it's gonna start putting down color after a little bit as well. Now, the reason it's doing it this way is we actually stagger the heads. So it's a clear and a white head before the color heads, right? The cyan, magenta, yellow, black, white and clear head. And then there's two more heads in front of it for a total of five as the channels are split. So it should only take about 10 minutes. It's going to print it all at once, color, white, clear, everything, and that'll be it. So the left side of the machine is where the carriage parks. It's the, basically a waste tray, right? So as the waste tray gets filled, you just drain it. There's no capping stations or anything like that. Manual, you know, the morning maintenance, manual maintenance would be to clean around the head, do a nozzle check every morning when you come in, do a quick purge of the nozzles, wipe the nozzles clean, and that's it. The printer also has a crash detect system. So on either side of the lamps, on the left and right of the carriage, if anything's in the way and hits the little levers, it actually will stop the carriage within about 8 centimeters. Oh, Steve, people can't see the video. I think that's better. So as I was saying, the on either side of the lamp, there is those crash detect bars. Can you guys see the video now? All right, perfect. Thank you.
Good. Sorry, I didn't spotlight it.
You guys are so responsive. I love it. If you guys have questions, please ask. You know, we're here to answer. If it's, you know, questions about the printer, inks, you know, chemistry, software, anything like that. The printer does have industrial vacuums on them. There's two zones, so you can actually turn on the front zone and turn off the back one. But because they're both hooked up to individual zones, the suction power is the same. It does use RecoGen 5 print heads, which are industrial. They last for years. If you take care of these print heads, you should be able to get 3 to 5 years, if not more. We got a question here about the outdoor durability of these signs. So one thing about outdoor durability is there's two different aspects, right? We're talking about light fastness, which is fade resistance. Fade resistance on inkjet inks is typically 2 to 3 years, depending upon location and the direction that the signs are facing. I mean, obviously, if you put a sign in Key West facing south, they may fade a little faster than a sign facing south in Wisconsin. But with that said, you are able to put a clear coat over the top of it, right? Like a Matthews paint, a liquid laminate, some sort of spray. Because you can't use a film laminate with a texture. And you can increase that light fastness from 2 years up to 5 years. There are some film laminates that could get you further, but that would be for flat printing only. It doesn't work well with textured feature or ADA braille. And now in terms of adhesion, I mean, if you put it outside, I would say it's going to be a temporary sign. It's only going to last a year or two outside. If you put a laminate over the top of it, it will last longer because it's encapsulated. The biggest thing with UV ink is that it will shrink and contract with heat, right? So, you know, it's 75 degrees out in the daytime and it's getting beaten by the sun. So the substrate's really like 95 degrees. And then when it gets cold at night down to 55 degrees, you know, that material, that metal or plastic, whatever it is, glass will shrink. Well, the ink shrinks and contracts at a slightly different rate than the material. So you do have to worry about it pulling itself apart. So you can actually see where, you know, signs where there's a bunch of little cracks in it in all different directions. That's from shrinkage. You know, you can put an overcoat over the top of it that will help hold everything together. So if you were putting these outside, I would probably recommend an overcoat because it is quite a bit of ink and it would be recommended. We have another question. No flex ink, or is this flexible ink, or is it rigid ink? This ink is actually in between flexible and rigid. It is LED curable, and it's with Ricoh Gen 5 printheads, there's much more flexibility when creating ink because you're able to use different chemicals, thicker chemicals than say you would with other printheads that are need thinner viscosities. So this ink actually does have good flexibility to it. So you can print to signs and bend the signs without having to worry about it cracking. Now, the more ink you put down, you know, that becomes, you know, more of an issue. But with these signs, I would imagine you'd be able to bend them quite a bit and still hold their shape and not crack. Another question, wondering if you could print to leather and fabrics with this printer. Not fabrics with this ink. It's not that flexible to be thrown into a wash or anything like that. Leathers might be possible. It depends on the application, but certainly leathers don't move around and aren't as flexible as, you know, polyesters, cottons, tri-blends. So you can see we're almost done here, but printed multiple names, different colors. There is a texture on where you see the eagle and the names. There's actually clear buildup there. We do that on purpose because it actually enhances the brass behind the name and makes it look, you know, as if it is three-dimensional, as if it's, it just makes the name and the light reflection through the clear ink look better. Whereas if we didn't do that, it would just be flat. It just adds more dimension. Again, if you have any questions, feel free. It does have a nice embossed look. And you can also do a deboss, right? So you could, instead of building the ink up to do an embossed look to it, you could build ink up around everything else and leave font below the ink so it has a debossed look to it.
So as that's printing, I could show you some examples here that we have.
This is another feature. It's more of a sponsorship plaque kind of thing. You can see the texture there. It is a different kind of texture than the one we're using. But you can see that the names and everything has clear ink over the top to make it pop a little bit and look embossed. And we're printing to, this is ink mark, our ink mark metal. Comes in brass, comes in silver. We have a white on silver and brass. It looks amazing when you're doing stuff like this. This is on the silver. On this one, we textured the dragon. So those scales on the dragon, everything about the dragon is dimensional. You can touch it, feel it. And then the sky in the background is metallic looking because we only printed the sky with no white background.
All right, so it's done. So
that's it. That's all she wrote. But the and again, these are 9x12. Using the badge function, right? So Susan John Smith, Susan Beach, Thomas Adams, you know, you can put in all these different things, different names, customization, you know, so that you're not creating, you know, 20, 30, 40 signs by yourself. The runtime is recorded in the RIP. So that was about 10 minutes. Ink cost is also recorded as well. Ink cost on this is about $2.60 per sign. And so if we were talking about doing a full bed, we'd be looking at, sorry, just a minute, just doing some math, about 40 signs on the UV84. You could do 40 of them at $2.60 a piece. That's $100 worth of ink for 40 signs. And the runtime to print something like this in textured mode is 32 square feet an hour. So it would take an hour to print all 40 signs on the table. We have a question here, if the ink mark mill is available in smaller sizes, or do you need to cut down from the larger panels, and is it easy to cut? So it is available in smaller sizes, yes. These are our quarter sheets. They're 2 feet by 4 feet. They're what we use for demos on larger machines, the UV53, the UV84, but you can get them in other sizes as well, smaller sizes. It is easy to cut. We just use a shear press to cut samples out. So when we're done here, Steve will go and cut these out on our little shear press. But it's very easy to cut. It's not super thick. So it really just shears quite nicely. It doesn't leave any burrs or anything like that either.
Also, this is another effect that this was actually similar, but we actually use the clipper ink to show you kind of that embossed look. So
on the eagle, yep.
You could see the difference. The eagle's kind of the inside of the eagle is colored in on the ones I just did, but you could also do it this way.
Yep. Do a knockout and
yep. So basically I would just knock out that center of the shape of the eagle and then just use a spot clear for all the shapes in there that make up the eagle.
All right, so the real question is, what did we print? Well, we printed this 9x12 sign, and the question you guys need to ask yourselves is, what could you do using the badge function? What could you do using, say, the memorial plaque like this, re-iron texture? What could you do to add that to your business? What could you do to make money with that? I mean, what do you think you could sell this for? That's the kind of questions you need to kind of take away from this, is how can you help move your business into a new niche, a new spot that maybe you haven't thought of before? Or maybe you are already doing this, but you didn't know about the badge function. So that is something to think about. With that, we are coming to the end of the demo. So what I would like to do is just leave this open for a little bit, and as you guys have questions, feel free to use the chat or the Q&A feature. And what we'll do is we'll answer them as they come up. And then we'll take this recording and we'll send it to you probably tomorrow after it's uploaded to YouTube. So thanks for your time, everybody. We really appreciate it. Feel free to reach out to us at info@directcolorsystems.com. Or you can reach out to us by calling the main number at 860-829-2244.
Thank you.
We do have a question here. I have a technical question. Why, when I make tactile or braille job, gives me a round. I have a technical question. Why, when I make a tactile or braille job, gives me around those lettering O dots, a yellow tarnish. What you're seeing is actually specific to the IR2 ink, is that the varnish, the clear ink, and in the other inks, the photo initiators are yellow. So they're basically powders that go into an ink that make it so it cures. These powders, some of them are white, some of them are yellow. Even if you put in a little bit of the yellow powders, which are, you know, good photo initiators, they help it cure quickly, effectively, so it doesn't stay wet. You'll get a little bit of that kind of golden color, but typically after about 24 hours, that basically goes away. So you should see that go away after 24 hours. If we don't have any other more questions, we'll end the session here, and I will post this to YouTube tomorrow and send everybody the link who is here today. Thank you very much for joining us, everybody. I hope you all have a great day, and we'll talk to you soon.
Thank you. Take care.
Bye.